I'm going to talk about now about the second neural network renaissance, which is currently ongoing, and I'll try to show you how you can win all kinds of pattern recognition competitions using our special breed of deep or recurrent neural networks. AGI is driven by two types of progress, at least. On the one hand, we have these new millennium results on optimal universal problem solvers that are theoretically unbeatable and mathematically optimal. But then we also have another type of progress driven by hardware advances. Computers are still getting faster by a factor of 100 or 1,000 per decade per cent. And this is what we are going to use in this talk. A long time ago, 20 years ago, my first student, Sepp Hochreiter, he showed that you cannot really train deep networks with many nonlinear layers or deep or recurrent networks, which you can translate into deep feed-forward networks, which have as many layers as there are time steps in the sequence that you are processing, because there's this vanishing gradient error problem. As you are increasing the number of layers, nonlinear layers, through which you are propagating in these networks, every time there's a new layer or a new time step, you decrease the error signal by at most a particular constant factor, which means that after it vanishes exponentially as you are adding layers and time steps, which means that you cannot really propagate far down in traditional networks like this. This prompted one of the pioneers of neural networks to say that nobody in his right mind would take a deep multilayer perceptron and train it by backprop. I won't mention this pioneer by name, except to say that he is Geoff Hinton. So nobody in his right mind, that seems like an accurate description of our neural computer vision team. Here we see Dan and Ueli and Jonathan and Alex. And so we took a deep multilayer perceptron with many layers and trained it by backprop. Although my own lab showed that you shouldn't really do that. However, something has changed because now computers are a million times faster than they used to be 20 years ago. And suddenly we can propagate errors down a little bit further than we used to. And now we can have as many layers in a deep network as are connecting our retinas with the visual cortex, 7, 8, 9, nobody knows exactly, something like that. And we applied that to the most famous benchmark of machine learning, which was developed in the lab of another pioneer of neural network of Yann LeCun in New York. And there's a long history of broken benchmark records on this problem, and many people use all kinds of support vector machines and whatever. However, our approach achieved a new world record just last year. And then we greatly profit from graphics cards, which makes everything 50 times faster than on traditional CPUs. Now, you can further improve this result if you take not only one deep network like that, but you can take 7 or 10, and then each of them is slightly differently initialized and maybe has slightly different pre-processing, and you get different experts automatically as a byproduct, as a random byproduct of that, and then you do a democratic committee which just takes the average of all these predictions of the different networks, and the result is better than any individual network, and this led to a new world record on the same data set, which is now 0.31%. And what you really should do is take not plain backprop, but something which is combining all kinds of ideas that range back to Fukushima, the neocognitron, and max pooling, which is a way of downsampling from one layer to the next, and convolution and weight sharing, where you have not as many free parameters as you would have in a plain deep network. And then the current world record on that MNIST problem is 0.27%. You can also do other images with that. For example, this is the Cypher object recognition problem of Geoff Hinton's group in Toronto. And there we also just a while ago broke the record on that one. And the current one, which is not even published yet, is now 13% on this one here. There you have to distinguish frogs from cars and horses and boats. I have a lot of problems with the frogs. And just a while ago, Ueli and Dan, they were instrumental in winning the Chinese handwriting recognition competition, which where we used exactly the same approach. Now, that's an interesting problem because unlike with MNIST, for example, you have not only 10 different patterns, but 4,000. And there we got the first and the second ranks. That was just 2 months ago. And if you look then at the details of these feature detectors that are being learned automatically as a byproduct of these deep networks, you see the stuff that you know from vision of decades ago. You get automatically you get Gabor filters and on center off surround detectors and orientation sensitive bar detectors in the lower layers, and as you are looking at feature detectors in higher layers, they get more and more opaque and intransparent and less and less clear what's going on there, just like in human brains. Now, we applied the same thing to the NORB object recognition benchmark and also set a new record. So I'm sorry, my slides are going to remain boring like that for a while, but then they will become boring in a different way. Yes, the traffic sign competition that took part in January, there was an online traffic sign competition, and our toughest competitors usually are those from Jan LeCun's lab. It's interesting to see that only neural networks are are now playing a part in these competitions, and no support vector machines, no boosting and all these things. It's a competition mainly between networks now, which is kind of unusual or unexpected, because 10 years ago, neural networks almost vanished from the scene because support vector machines were so much better in many applications. And for a long time, it was not possible to publish anything at the leading neural network conferences that had the word neural in the title. And there, on the last day of the competition, where we thought we have a comfortable lead, then suddenly Pierre Samani of Jan LeCun's lab, he had an even better result. And then Dan and Uli and Jonathan worked late night to reestablish the correct order. And then the best teams of that time, they were invited just a couple of days ago to the IJCNN conference, where the goal was to take the new data set with more data and then participate in the final competition. And down there we see Dan with the number one traffic sign that you can see in his hands. There, the differences were unexpectedly high. So Pierre Samani, this time of New York University, of Jan LeCun's lab, achieved 1.69% correct. Then the second best were the humans. Humans are able to get 1.16% correct, according to the conference organizers, and first place for our team with 0.56% error. Now, this might be of interest to everybody who is doing self-driving cars, and of course, we all remember the this incredible keynote of Ernst Dickmanns, who is not using GPS for self-driving cars, but is doing it in the human-like way, and in 1995 already used these active vision systems to drive from Munich to Denmark and back in traffic with up to 12 vehicles surrounding the car and tracking them all using these. How many people saw this talk and how the camera swiveled along there, the active vision camera? I think this will also be the future of self-driving cars, in addition to GPS and radar and LIDAR. But to do fast driving, you just have to ask Ernst Dickmanns. You need these active vision techniques for getting high resolution input of stuff that is far ahead. As you are driving fast, you need to look far ahead to be able to brake in time if there's an obstacle on the street. And so LIDAR or something like that is not sufficient. Now, once you have identified salient points, then you still have to do the traffic sign recognition or pedestrian error recognition or whatever you want to recognize there. And there, at the moment, I think I can recommend this technique. Now, of course, in the long run, we don't just want to recognize patterns that are single patterns by feed-forward networks. No, we have streams of patterns, videos essentially, where there is no segmentation where no nobody segmented the stream into relevant parts, and to do that we cannot use feedforward networks. There we really have to use recurrent networks, which are general computers. And one of the examples of applications is connected handwriting. Connected handwriting, there somebody scribbles something and you are supposed to translate that into plain text, which means you have a rather short label sequence. However, you have a long real-valued input sequence of pixels that you are sequentially observing. And there you need a recurrent network and preferably a long short-term memory network that can really deal with these long delays between relevant events. And Alex Graves, my former PhD student and then postdoc, who is now going to Geoff Hinton's lab, actually, he used this approach in conjunction with a technique called connectionist temporal classification, which maximizes the probability of the label sequences given these long real-valued input sequences without any pre-segmentation, and then applied that to various handwriting recognition competitions, connected handwriting, and so that's how he won the French handwriting connected handwriting competition and the Farsi connected handwriting competition and the Arab connected handwriting recognition contest without speaking any word of Arabic. You may have guessed that that the Swiss AI lab is in Switzerland, and in Switzerland, traffic signs are really important. If you don't obey a traffic sign in Switzerland, you go to jail. However, across the border, there is Italy. And in Italy, they also have traffic signs in the street, however, only for decoration. Well, we are currently trying to write a book about things like that. And I think that's the end of my talk. Thank you.